Hi, I hope you can you hear me? Okay. Before I start, I just want to thank the team, all of these who have been so helpful and so wonderful with me in the last kind of couple of weeks. And it would be remiss of me to start without mentioning my wonderful younger brother who passed away 2 weeks ago at the age of 56. And we just listened to death and stuff like that. So I have been going through the mill, different emotions, as you can imagine. And I will continue my story as in this time, 19 years ago, I was on a life support machine in Chelsea Westminster Hospital. Today I work there, and I work at HIV Ireland, and I speak out for people living with HIV, the minorities, the marginalization of our lives, and how we are treated as human beings. I was born in Granite County, Longford in 1958, which makes me 65. In 8 months' time, I'll be a senior citizen, you know. When I was diagnosed with HIV in 1987, it was actually AIDS I was diagnosed with. HIV hadn't even come into the equation. And the only reason I had a HIV test or an AIDS test was I was having my surgeries to become the complete person I am today. I was all excited about it. I was hurt because here in Ireland I'd lost my career. I had been a top hair and makeup artist, a model agent. I had just done the Eurovision Song Contest with Johnny Logan, Linda Martin, all of these people. U Magazine, Image Magazine, It Magazine, Television, you mentioned it, I was doing it. I was in my 20s. The height of career, money, everything. And all of a sudden, somebody leaked it to the papers about me transitioning. I lost everything. Like literally overnight, I lost my career. All of a sudden, I wasn't a hair and makeup artist anymore. I wasn't a model agent. In fact, I didn't even qualify to be a human being. That's how bad it was. My family suffered. The red top papers had me in everything. They didn't even know the damage they were doing, that they were doing to people like myself. But they were getting my papers. So I ended up leaving Ireland before I was burned to a stake. And I went from being all of that to working the streets of Soho. And I can tell you, here and now, that was not on my to-do list. But it was what I had to do to survive and thrive. And I found my people there because it was a melting pot of everything. It was before pronouns. It was before we looked at people of color or white. I met my people there, my tribe there, that were of every color, every nation. And I loved them and they loved me. But I had to step through just to survive. Pay for my surgery. That led to alcoholism. I was a heroin addict. Crack, all of that. I got raped by 3 guys one night because I owed £25 for crack pipe. And I even asked for more after that. That's how low I had become. It got to a stage in my life on those streets. I had to do a double take. Was I ever at that Eurovision? Was I ever that hair and makeup artist? Was I ever even that human being? People in this room today have heard from you. I know what homeless is like. I come from a middle class family in Ranelagh. I never thought in a million years I'd catch HIV. And I went, because it was compulsory for me to have a test, because I was having surgery. I was getting my vagina, and I so wanted this vagina. Then I'm told I have AIDS, and I've under 2 years to live. And the only question I asked that doctor, can I still have my surgery? I was told no. I was was sent home to try my nearest and dearest. I did that. Amen. At this stage, my family were dealing with me, being in the press, being asleep, being whatever they were calling me. And now I'm telling them my age and I have 2 years to live. They didn't know what to do. I was brought to this monastery by my beautiful, wonderful late Auntie Sybil, who was a wonderful woman, who came to get us to sight. We drove down just before we got to Monte Carlo, because we had to go for a drink. I wasn't even drinking at the time. She had a few whiskies. We went up, came out, and said, "Well, this is me, well, love." I said, "I feel, exactly the same, Auntie Sybil." She said, "I thought so." But within that time, I lost my family, living in London, living this precarious life of not knowing where I was living, being treated like as a trans person. Even if I did get housed, it was in some area where I'd be beaten up. That still happens today. The reason why I have to round my story off because of who I am today. Today, I'm 65. I'm a parent. I'm a granny to an 18-year-old who did a leaving cert this year and robbed my clothes. But that child of mine was taken from me because I wasn't normal in society. But you can never keep people from people. But then I got a job in the right venue in 2009. All burlesque. Feathers coming out of everywhere. Believe me, the money was worth it. You'd have done it too. I was working there 1 month and discovered I was working with my beautiful daughter. She'd seen me on stage and had often wondered how her parents had done that thing and wished it was somebody like me. A week later, she finds out about it. I mean, you just could not make this up. Some people have said, "Oh, that can't be true. I have witnesses to prove it's true." A nightclub of people. And it was then I discovered I had this beautiful granddaughter 3 years of age. She is the light of my life. She wraps me around her finger because I love her. I have my family in my life today. I was able to be at my brother's funeral with the rest of my family and some calling time. You're looking at me here today, a successful woman, proud to work at HIV Ireland, proud to work at 516 Street London, and also Trans HIV Testing. Yes, I've written a book, but in that book, I didn't mention HIV 10 years ago, because I was goddamn terrified too. But I outed myself on social media, and it changed everything. But you're looking at one woman standing up here. I am a woman that had a trans experience. I've always known I've been a female. I've had to pay the highest price just to be me. There are loads of other trans people out there, struggling, suffering. I'm just their voice today, because I'm good. I'm good. I'm being treated as much like a human being as I can possibly expect of me. We still have a way to go. I'm still a trans woman. I still tick a box. But people forget I have a brain. I have a voice, which is the biggest thing. And I have my own television show that I've just finished filming called Rebecca's Second Chances. She aired on Virgin Media next year. That is history making. I'm making history again because I was officially the first trans woman to transition in this country. I changed the passport. I didn't do it for everybody else. I did it very selfishly for myself because I got stopped coming out of the country. And I went from lady to ghetto in the passport office like that. And they gave me, I had my vagina, I had my breasts, I had everything you see here. and my female name, but it still said sex male. How can society do that to any of us on any level? I'm one trans woman with a voice. I still get kind of shunned a little bit, even within my own community, when I bring up sex work. That's HIV. HIV for a trans woman is not just stigma, it's taboo. Because we're already stigmatized. And then I think of women, menopausal women. Like fight, privileged, middle class women have no idea they can catch this. They think it comes to, it's either black women or it comes from the gay community. Honey, HIV is not fussy. You don't know that from COVID. It didn't care whether you're rich, poor, whatever. Whatever color you are or not. If you're a nice person, if you're a horrible person, you can catch these things. But we need allies. We need support. We need money, for God's sake, to help these things move on. And today, I'm standing up here, and I continue to stand here, and on many stages, as I have done throughout Europe. I was silenced by my own stigma for 29 years about being HIV. Today, I am a VIP with HIV. And when you see this woman walking down the street, to most people it looks like I have no care in the world and anything like that. Never, ever, 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 ever judge a book by its cover. Because you just never know what's going on behind her. Did you? If somebody comes to you and they're trans, how do we deal with this? You heard girls say about pronouns. They weren't around in my day. He, him, they, them. I get it wrong. But if you ask, feel free to ask. And you know what? If somebody comes out and they're trans or HIV to you, what do you do? Give them a hug. Today you have been listening to the wonderful Rebecca Tallon de Havilland. Thank you.